Good morning. He was a man who loved a chat, and most of the time he would let us all eavesdrop on those conversations. Sir Michael Parkinson brought out the best in practically everyone, including plenty of Australians. He is being remembered today as the most outstanding interviewer of a generation. Here's our Europe correspondent, Carrie-Anne Greenbank.
Well, by his own estimate, Sir Michael Parkinson interviewed around 2,000 of the world's biggest stars on his chat show during his decades-long programming, which started here at the old BBC studios in 1971. Dozens of those stars have been paying tribute to the veteran broadcaster, and his family has also released a statement. He's survived by his wife, Mary, and three children. They say after a brief illness, Sir Michael Parkinson passed away peacefully at home last night in the company of his family. David Beckham saying, "We say goodbye to the best. Waking up to the sad news of Michael Parkinson passing, I was so lucky to not just be interviewed by Michael, but to be able to spend precious time talking about football and family, our two passions," and he refers to that golden balls moment. Sir Elton John, "Michael Parkinson was a TV legend. He was one of the greats. I loved his company," calling him a real icon who brought out the very best in his guests. And from Sir David Attenborough, "The best interviewer in the business. He was extremely generous, he wanted you to shine and would always laugh at your jokes." And the BBC has announced it is interrupting its broadcasting today to run a special documentary honouring the legendary broadcaster.
Well, Nine's entertainment editor Richard Wilkins joins us now. Dickie, welcome. He was one of the greatest interviewers. What made him so special?
Well, I think those people said it far more eloquently than I could. He was just a knockabout bloke. He came from very humble beginnings. He was in the right place at the right time to interview literally the biggest stars on the planet, the biggest names in the business. And he was there when someone said, "Why don't we have a Tonight chat show on the BBC and do it live, and to people, we'll get a band, we'll get a studio audience and all that." And he said, "Oh, well, give it a crack." Yeah, and the rest really is history. He was wonderful. He listened. The word that last night several of us were ringing each other, and the word that kept resonating with me was authentic. Mm-hmm. He was the real deal. He was in the right place to do a great job, and he loved it. He was fiercely interested in sport. He loved his cricket and his footy and, you know, and people. He was great, man.
He resonated so much with the viewers, despite the who's who of who he mixed with. Do you think, you mentioned his humble beginnings, was that some of the influence of why he was so successful?
I think so, because his family, they were a family of miners. They'd all, you know, been down in mines. His dad used to sit in front of the fire, you know, in a tub to get that damn stuff off his skin. And Sir Michael, well, Michael was destined to do that, but he's told me, he said to his dad in the early days, he said, "I'm never going to do that." His dad said, "God for that." You know? But, you know, it was the advent, it was sort of a golden age of television, really, when, you know, the celebrity circuit was opening up. People were promoting movies and books and television show and albums. John Lennon. They actually lost, I believe, that whole series of interviews that John Lennon featured in, and someone not so long ago found that and had it restored. But yeah, he was a great man. I mean, he didn't like a lot of the new things about television, but he certainly was a man for the right time, for the ages.
So many Aussies that he interviewed, John Lennon, Barry Humphries, Ali was one of the most extraordinary interviews.
Well, lots of Aussies. Dame Edna was one of his absolute favourites, and his show, Warnie, of course. But his show was so suited for Dame Edna, for people like Edna, because it was, you know, he had a big team of producers and researchers, and they'd speak to the guests a lot beforehand and sort of green room them, as we say, know what they were going to say and give Michael some questions. But, you know, he made it his own, and he knew how to get the best out of people.
We've seen Shane Warne there as well, Ali. Let's have a listen to just one of the many interviews he did with Muhammad Ali, who became a great friend of his.
Mm. I never got hurt. It's strange.
Oh, you must have got hurt in the ring.
Where?
Well, I mean, I saw you fight Joe Frazier.
I didn't get hurt.
You didn't?
No.
You did, a very good actor.
Yeah, no. Are you calling me a liar?
No.
Yeah, he interviewed Muhammad Ali four times, and the last time, when Ali was definitely wearing the scars of you know, his what he did for a job, Michael was clearly concerned about him and wanted him to stop fighting. But these two had a great rapport, and they were both great showmen. They knew exactly what was going on.
They became friends.
Yeah.
You were lucky enough to call him a friend.
I'd call him a mate, yeah.
Yeah, let's take a listen to one of your interviews that you did with him.
You say that standing on top of that staircase in the studio was some of the happiest times of your life,
yeah.
Listening to your big, beautiful band and all that. Were you ever nervous, anxious?
I wasn't terrified. I was elated more than anything else. I stand there and think, how did this happen to me, for God's sake? By what right am I standing here?
Yeah. What was that like for you?
Well, we did that interview. The last time I interviewed Parky was 4 years ago in England, it's a long trip to England, and of course, if you think about it all the way, I was concerned, what's my first question going to be?
A lot to talk about and think about. And,
but I said to the producer, I said, I've got the first question, I've got it down. And they said, what? And I said, wait and see. And my first question was, when you're sitting opposite someone, how important is that first question?
Yep.
And he said, oh, I've never been asked that before.
No.
I'm like, ah, you beauty. But he was a lovely man, and he was there for all the right reasons. It was a great honour to sit down with him and reflect. We had a whole lot of photos and got him to sort of reminisce about it all. You know you're in the company of greatness when you're sitting opposite Michael Parkinson.
And he even wrote in your book, the book that he wrote and he inscribed in the front.
He did. He wrote, to a fellow veteran hack, which I take exception to, he's considerably older than me. But he said, respect, regards, and all the best, Michael Parkinson. Respect is another word, you know. He showed respect to all those who he met and interviewed, and he got it back in return. Everybody who respected him.
Appreciated their talents.
Exactly.
Thank you so much, Dickie.
Thank you.
Well, ceremonies are being held around the country today to mark 50 years since the end of Australia's involvement in the Vietnam War. Of the 66,000 Australians who served and were called up, 523 lost their lives, another 3,000 were wounded. The Prime Minister attending a service in Ipswich, west of Brisbane, honouring the sacrifice and generational suffering of our vets.
Let us acknowledge the weight of what you lived through, what you saw, what you felt. The nights that took on a sense of menace you never knew before, and the realisation that just as much could lie hidden in bright sunshine.
The conflict deeply unpopular, so many vets received a hostile reception on their return home, despite being conscripted to fight. A man has been charged with murder over a deadly altercation at a Gold Coast pub overnight. Bailey Kenzie reports.
A 26-year-old man is dead and another remains in police custody this morning after a night out here on the Gold Coast turned deadly. Police were called to the scene at 10:15 last night, where they found the Narang man, who was believed to have been stabbed following an altercation with the other man outside the pub. He was rushed to hospital but was unable to be saved. At this stage, it is unclear as to whether the two men were known to each other. Police claim the second man, also aged 26, fled the scene but was later arrested at Mermaid Beach.
And that's what knife crime does. You know, it turns minor incidents into major incidents, and it wrecks lives, and it wrecks obviously the victim's life, and it will wreck the suspect's life as well.
None of these things happen here. You know, it's a very safe area. It's a shame because someone did lose their life. It's just very sad.
It remains a crime scene here at Robina this morning. Police are appealing for any witnesses and also anyone who may have information to come forward immediately.